you this morning, but all you ought to be glad this morning. Be able to lift up your hands, say yes, Lord. Whatever you need from me this morning, yes, Lord.
Father God, yes, Father God, we ask that you bless sick and shut in, Father God. That's the deacon boy who was not here, Father God. Whatever reason may be, Father God, we ask that you grant them favor too, Father God. Bless the magician, Father God, that bring the sounds out here, Father God. We ask that you bless those in the clergy, Father God. Bless those in the clergy who surround them, pastor, Father God. Father God, lift them up, Father God, so they can lift the pastor up, Father God, so they can lift the whole congregation up, Father God. God. Yes, sir. Bless them in a mighty special way, Father God. They can come out of school, get ready to start their journey in the summer, Father God. Yes, that you bless those who are out there on the danger highways and byways, Father God. We dispatch your angel right now, Father God. Oh God, we need you right now, Father God. Oh God, we ask that you go by the prison, Father God. Turn them in the mighty special way, God. Oh God, we know that you got all power in your hand, Father God. We ask that you come into our home. Come into our home, Father God. Father God, what is broken, we ask that you to fix it right now.
6.
Around for me.
be like this. God will perfect that concerning me. And sooner or later, it's gonna turn in my favor. I believe it. It's turning around for me. Hallelujah. I see things getting better. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I see doors opening. Hallelujah. I see opportunities that we didn't even think about yet. Hallelujah. I hear people talking about you that you don't even know their names. Hallelujah. Yes. Jesus, thank you, God. Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse 25. When you've arrived, say amen.
Amen.
Starting at verse 25. This is Jesus speaking to the disciples. He's teaching them the way of the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All of us are seeking after one thing or another.
Amen.
We're all seeking for something. Amen. Some people wake up and they pursue worldly things. Mm-hmm. Some people wake up and they pursue other people. Some people pursue money. It just depends on what your mindset is. Amen.
Amen.
But we are forever chasing after something.
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. Jesus says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not life more than meat, and the body than raiment or clothing? He says, observe, behold the fowls of the air, for they don't sow, neither do they reap, neither gather they into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they are? Which of you, by taking thought, or by worrying, or obsessing over something constantly, can add one cubit to your stature? And why do you take thought for clothing? He says again, consider, think about this. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They don't toil, neither do they spin. Yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not dressed like one of these. Therefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, take no thought saying, what shall I eat, or what shall we drink, or what are we going to put on? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. People who don't know God. People who live in the pursuit of their flesh. This is what they seek after. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. Then he gives us the key right here. He says, but seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Again, take no thought for tomorrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day the evil thereof is the evil thereof. Amen.
Amen.
Father God, allow me to decrease, God, as you increase in me. Father God, allow your Holy Spirit, God, to overshadow me, God, to minister to your people, God. Feed your people your word, God, that it might bear much fruit in them, Father. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Jesus is teaching a lesson to his disciples again because he wants them to have an understanding of where their mindset should be, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You show me, I remember somebody showing me, I'm saying, You show me where you spend your money, and I'll show you what your priorities are.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Your money and your time. Amen. People make room for what they want to make room for.
Well, amen.
Amen. It depends on what you hold to be very important. Here, Jesus addresses the things that the people have been obsessing over. And truth be told, we either live in one or two categories. The church of today, we've found ourselves in a particular situation where the church is in the bless me position. Amen.
Amen.
We're stuck. We're stuck in the bless me position. That means that it's pastor's job to tell you how God is going to give you a new car, how God's going to send you a husband, how God's going to straighten out your credit, how God's going to give you that house that you can't afford, how God's going to do this for you, how God's going to do that for you, because he's a bless me God, amen. I don't know, but I remember somewhere, amen, that's called a genie, where you can rub it, you rub on the lamp the right way and get yourself three wishes, amen. But not so with God. The church has been fooled into believing that God, the sovereign creator of all the universe, that his job is to sit on high and simply just give us what we want. He's not Santa Claus. Can I get a witness up in here? You don't write out your Christmas list and say, God, these are the things that I need you to do, and this is when I need you to do it, and this is how I need you to do it. Amen? But it says the Gentiles said they seek after, said, Lord, what are we going to eat on today? And what are we going to drink on today? And what are we going to wear on today? Truth be told, the level of expectation is very low. Because they don't ask the question, Michael, where is my life going? Where am I going to be 10 years from now? What is the future of my kids going to look like? They don't have the ability to see past their next meal. And that's a very basic way to live, amen, because it keeps you in a box, amen. Some of us have had to live in literally from paycheck to paycheck and from dollar to dollar, and you have to borrow dollars here, and you have to beg for dollars there, but I heard somebody say, amen, I make a nickel, but I have to pay out a dime. Can I get a witness up in here? And for some of us, the stresses of life can become so strenuous, and that we're not able to see past the light bill. We're not able to see past the monthly budget. We can't see past the car note. But that's the trap of the enemy to keep you blind to what's really important in your life. He figures that if he can keep your mind tied up in your next meal, if he can keep your mind tied up worried over the light bill and the water bill and the car note and all these things that God knows that we have need of, but they become the primary goals of our lives. You don't live to pay bills. He didn't create you just to pay bills. He created you for more than that. You see, that's called existing. But Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. He says, you worried about stuff that you have no kind of control over. He said, you laid up all night long and you worried about it and you scratched your head about it and you lost sleep over it and you called and worried other folks about it, and nobody can do anything about the situation. But if you took time to pick up your Bible, I got a way to handle that thing for you. If you refocus what's important in your life, and the problem is the light bill is more important than your relationship with God. Your God note is more important than your prayer life with God. Hallelujah. You will go to work, but you won't go on your knees and seek the God who gives every good and perfect gift. Hallelujah. Say, so you worrying over this stuff, and you worrying over it ain't changing nothing. He says, think about it. The birds wake up in the morning. They don't clock in and they don't clock out. My man, they don't go to the kitchen, they don't open up the refrigerator. They simply open their eyes. And as they begin to venture out, God puts their provision in front of them where they're able to eat and be satisfied. And not only that, they're able to feed the baby birds too. And they're able to take care of the nest. And they didn't go out there and sow or they didn't sow nothing, but God makes sure to take care of them. The Bible says not one of them falls to the ground and God doesn't have knowledge of it. He says if God cares for the birds of the air, he says you're much better than them.
That's right.
How much more will he take care of you?
Amen.
Then he says we worried about the kind of clothes that we're going to put on. And he says, go look at the flowers of the field, the roses and the violets and the lilies and the sunflowers. And he says that they don't go to the store. They don't go to Walmart. They don't go to all the fancy clothing stores. And they don't purchase. But God, he says, they look better than anybody who was ever dressed. Can I get a witness up in here? God says, none of these things take care of themselves, but it's I who take care of them. And he says that I've created you much better than them. He says, I can do more for you than you can do for yourself. Can I get a witness up here? But we have to get out of, we're stuck in the bless me position, because everybody wakes up saying, God can do this for me. Amen. I wish God would do this for me. I wish God would do that for me. But nobody ever stops to ask the question, what can I do for God? Was it John F. Kennedy who said, ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. Amen. While we're out there seeking, because we're stuck in a bless me mentality, and instead of having our hands out, we should be offering our hands in service unto God. Maybe it is if you take care of God's business, that he'll take care of your business. If you really believe in God and he's the author and the finisher of your life, if he is the one that supplies all of your needs according to his riches and glory, if he is the one, when you get Jesus, you get everything. You get everything else. It all belongs to him.
He says,
I know you have need of all these things. Not that they're not important, but they're not the most important thing.
Hallelujah.
He says, but if you would follow sound instruction and seek ye first. Somebody say first. That means it has to take priority in your life. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the other things shall be added unto you. When I say, well, preacher, what do you mean seek first the kingdom of God? Well, what are you talking about? If you look at the basic translation, in the Greek translation, in the original Aramaic, it says, it translates like this. It says, seek first God's way of doing things, and then all the other things will be added unto you. You see, that's the key that unlocks the potential right there. You see, the stuff you've been trying to get, you've been trying to get it your own way. Amen. And your way is insufficient because you don't have all knowledge and all understanding. He said, but if you seek God's way of doing things, I'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out the blessing that you don't have room enough to receive. I'll cause men to give it to your bosom, good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over. Hallelujah. I fill your wine presses. I fill your storehouses until they overflow. Hallelujah. But when I focus on God's things, they don't hold high priority in our life. Amen. Amen. And then we want God to serve us, but we don't want to serve him. We want God to bless us, but we don't want to work for him. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You say, Lord, I need this bill paid. And he says, I need you to pray for this person over here. We neglect the things of God, and we want a one-way kind of relationship. But any type of relationship where all you do is take and you don't give anything back will not be a relationship for very long. Can I get a witness up in here? For all that you get, for all that God does for you, what do you contribute to the kingdom of God? When the kingdom gets you, what does it get? What do you bring to the table? You wouldn't let nobody live in your house who just ate up all the food, use all the lights, use all the resources, but they didn't want to give anything back. And we act like we have lost our minds. You're living today because God brought you from a mighty long way, and you owe the kingdom something. This give me generation. Give me this and give me that. We don't earn nothing. Just give me because you're supposed to give me. But if we love God, we'll keep his commandments. He wants something from you too. If you think you got all the time in the world to do what you want to do, and you don't want to do what God wants you to do, and the clock is ticking on your life, and you're going to lift up your eyes one day, and God is going to demand of you an answer for all the time that you wasted, for every time you neglected to do what he called you to do.
Amen.
We'll look the part, but we ain't did nothing that God has asked us to do.
Amen.
And you're not fooling the person next to you. You're not fooling me. I ain't fooling you. God keeps an account.
Yes.
Well, yes. My God
said every knee shall bow.
Amen.
And every tongue shall confess that he's Lord to the glory of God the Father. Can I get a witness up in here? Every tongue shall confess. You're going to have to give an account for everything that you did. Well, what were you doing? When you know I called you to serve in this ministry, I was pursuing my own stuff. Oh my God, there's a scripture that says, there's a scripture that says, there was a rich man and he had large barns, large storehouses, and he had great land. And he harvested all he brought in all of his harvest. And he filled the storehouses until they were running over. And he had all everything that he wanted. And he sat down and says, I'm a blessed man.
Well,
and then the scripture says that God speaks and says, you fool, you don't know that this night your life will be required of you?
My Lord.
What are you storing up for? All that stuff you're working for, somebody else gonna get it after you. But he says, don't lay up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and dust and the IRS and thieves break through and steal. Amen. You got more stuff than you know what to do with, because the stuff was supposed to be, you see, the runover blessing is for somebody else. That's why you don't have room for it.
Amen.
And so you will keep what God intended to bless someone else with, and it'll wind up corrupting in your hand anyway. Somebody come take it away. You lose it some kind of way. Some kind of way it's going to be gone.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. But he said, this night your life will be required of you. Don't store for yourself treasures on earth where moth and dust doth corrupt, but store for yourself treasures in heaven where moth nor dust does corrupt and where thieves do not break through and steal.
Oh, yeah.
I'll tell you how grandma said it, right? I'm sending up my temper.
Amen.
I'm looking forward to something after all of this.
Amen.
Paul said it, and I'm done. Paul said it like this. And they all say the same thing. Paul said it like this right here. He said, everything that I have on earth, I count it as dung for the excellency of knowing Christ Jesus, having Jesus in my life. Y'all know what dung is? Huh? I'm going to have to turn off the camera to say this. Amen. Dung is boo-boo.
Wow.
everything that I've accumulated in my life is the equivalent of excrement compared to the excellency of knowing God, because I can't take it with me. God knows I need it, but if my life is built around the pursuit of it, then I'm going to miss it, because the greatness that God really put within me will never be realized. I'll never reach my full potential chasing after stuff that doesn't glorify God.
Amen.
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 Your life has to count for something.
Amen.
You can play around, waste your life, trick around, do all that stuff you want to do, but all of us going to wind up at the same judgment seat of Christ.
Amen.
And you will give an account. What did you do with your life? Because now this one is over.
Amen.
You can't play around anymore. This one is over. And you've laid up for yourself an eternal life, either in heaven or in hell.
Amen.
And there's no leaving either one. It's real. Amen. People are dying. Yeah. Amen?
Amen.
And we got some hard decisions, some hard choices to make. Whose side will you be on?
Amen.
Who's on the Lord's side? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We got to get our priorities right. Amen.
Amen.
We can play around with one. I'm done. Stand to your feet. Amen.
Amen.
Before I die, before I leave here, amen. It is my goal to make sure that I've pushed you, urged you, persuaded you,
amen,
to seek God, to seek more for your lives. Amen.
Amen.
To seek God's purpose for your life. That's my purpose, to push you into seeking your purpose. Amen.
Amen.
What are you chasing after? What are you going after? What takes up a majority of your thought life? Amen.
Amen.
What was on your mind when you woke up this morning? Is that all you think about? Is that what your life revolves around? Is that going to be what they remember you for? What are you going to leave behind? I mean, will anybody know that you were here when you're gone? What will it all mean? Amen?
Amen.
Father God, we thank you right now, God.
Right now, Lord.
Father, we thank you for renewed strength, God. God, we thank you for new power, God.
Yes, God.
Lord, we thank you for fresh eyes, oh God.
Yes, God.
And ears that can hear, Lord God.
Yes, God.
Lord, make us uncomfortable. Shake us out of our sleep, oh God.
Yes, God.
Agitate us, oh God. God, shake our worlds up, God, until we wake up and understand, Father God, that we don't have forever to do what you called us to do, oh God. God, forgive us for playing around. God, forgive us for the time that we wasted, God. Lord, we belong to you. We thank you for your son, Jesus, God. We thank you for salvation, oh God. But, Father God, show us how we can be of use in your kingdom. God, we want to serve you. We want to love you, God. God, we want to give your name glory, God. God, we don't want your name to be put to shame because of our actions, oh God. But God, begin to transform our lives, God. Father God, get our attention, oh God. Whatever it takes, oh God. God, pull us into our purpose in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you, Father God, for every plan that you have for every life in here, God. Father God, we thank you, God, that it's a great and glorious future that we have. God, we thank you, Father God, for all that you're doing. So God, even now, we submit to your will for our life, oh God. God, we seek the kingdom of God this morning and all of your righteousness. God, give us the things that we need, Father God. But Father God, show us the things that we must do also. And we'll be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name this morning, amen.
Amen.
Amen.